this all put together by the mic was putting, but there's an echo. So you know how it is, not echo, but there's a shortage. You know, like it cuts out, and very frustrating for us, right? When we listen to a preacher, it cuts out. So I have the microphone. Amen. So my text is found, before I forget, I thank Pastor for the opportunity to preach. I don't preach much. When Pastor said, preach, I have to preach. Right? So, Pastor, thank you. The text is found in John chapter 6, verses 1 through 15. This is about the miracle of the loaves and fishes. Now, I did some research, not intensive research, but I kind of have an idea. People use the word miracle in so many ways. How many of you know Smokey Robinson and the Miracles? A couple guys raise their hand. How about Miracle Whip? No? No? How about Miracle Grow? Those people who does garden, Miracle Grow. Right? What else? Pastor Jama should know this. What happened in 1980? Related to sports, hockey. Miracle on Ice. That's when U.S. beat the Soviet Union. They were highly favored, but U.S. won the hockey. I have one more. I kind of searched more on the web. This one says food miracle or something, some kind of food miracle food or something like, what would you, miracle, no, miracle noodle. Like, I gotta try that. What kind of noodle is that? Is it gonna fill you up real good? But the miracle that we're talking today is about the loaves and fishes. And this miracle is found in four Gospels, besides the resurrection of Christ. This miracle is found in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is found there. It's the only miracle that is found in that. And this miracle, when I'm starting this message, so many insights, so many details. When you start studying the Word of God, there's a lot of details, insight. And we shouldn't say, well, I read John 3:16 before, I shouldn't read no more. No, read it. There's a lot of insight that the Holy Spirit will give to you. And because the Word is not dry, is not stale, they are new every morning. They are new every morning. What is the greatest miracle do you think happened? What is the greatest miracle? Besides the resurrection, guess what is the greatest miracle of all time? This is according to pastors and researchers and scholars and Bible scholars. Genesis 1:1. God created the heaven and the earth. If you look at it, do your research, this universe is massive. Massive. Lots of galaxies. I mean, one galaxy alone is like 100 billion stars plus. And there's 100 billion galaxies. So put that into perspective how big our universe is. Who created the universe? God created the universe. God created the universe. So God turning the loaves and fishes into more, so you can see the 5,000. That's, they call it in Hawaii, manini. It's too small. So if you believe in Genesis 1:1, you can believe anything that God can do in your life, in my life. just remember that. That God created the universe, and this universe, even though the scripture says the heavens declares His glory, God's glory. He is a big God. When God created the heavens and the earth, that's when time starts, because God does it run by time. So when He created the universe, time started. That's for us. Not for Him. He doesn't run by time. He doesn't run by time. So let's read our scripture. Okay, verse 1, he says, let me go here. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed the far shore of the Sea of Galilee. This is the Sea of Tiberias. And a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. Then Jesus went up on the mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Not to get filled, just to have a bite. Another disciple, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place. The Bible is very detailed, right? And John detailed here, he included the grass, green grass. And they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. So this is like buffet, right? He did the same with the fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." So he gathered them and filled 12 baskets. Remember that, okay? 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. After the people saw the sign Jesus performed, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world." Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for today. Thank you, Lord, for an awesome worship time with you, Lord. We join heaven in worshiping you, Lord. We worship you, Lord, in spirit and truth. We worship you, Lord, because you are an awesome God. You are an amazing God. You are a faithful and gracious God. And we thank you, O Lord Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, for this day, for this is the day you have made. We come and rejoice. We thank you, Lord, for your scripture, Lord, that has been read, O Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this time, O Lord, that this message be delivered by your servant. For I am nothing, O Lord, without your help. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for I'm about to say, Lord, that help me, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for you. We love you, we honor you, we exalt you, we lift you up, for your name is above all name, the name that is mighty. We thank you, Lord. Bless your people this morning as we open the ears and hearts to listen to your word. We thank you in Jesus' name. Everybody say, amen. Thank you. Okay, I have 3 points. I mentioned earlier before we pray with the worship team and the leaders. I thank Pastor Phil that he emphasized or encouraged us to have 3 points, because if you have 4, 5, 6 points, you'll be here all day. Right? 3 points is a good start for me anyway, who I hardly preach. Right? So I have 3 points. So number 1 point. Okay, number 1 point is the compassion of Jesus. Number 2 point is trust the Lord, the great I am. Number 3, the Lord uses anyone, great and small. So number 1 point. Let me start from the beginning. So, as I read the scripture, Jesus and the disciples been busy, right? They're going around town, around the Sea of Galilee. So, Jesus performed the turning the water into wine in Cana, right? And the second one that is recorded, the person who's by the pool of Bethesda. So this time they're going up to pretty much their hometown. They're going home, so they passed by this place. So in verse 5, if you put up that landing, please. So they're all, Jesus and the disciples, sitting down the hillside, and then here comes this cloud, big cloud, right? When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" Now in Mark, Mark has a different take on it. Same story, but different angle. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion, underline the word compassion, on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. So Jesus, when he saw the crowd, the multitude, he had compassion. He felt for them, right? He felt for them. He knew already that they're following him because of the food, right? Or his miracles, the miracles of the sick. But he had compassion on them. Bible scholars say he had this, you know, when you have your compassion, or you're being compassionate of a certain person, you like it kind of like touches your stomach, right? Like your stomach turns, like when somebody tells you a story, and then like make my stomach sick, or like, you know, like you kind of, it bothers you. And some Bible scholars say it really not bothered Jesus, but he really, I mean, God already got to him, that you see this multitude following him to see him, to, because he's done a lot of miracles in healing the sick. Now in Matthew 9:36, it also talks about God's compassion. But I'm not gonna read that. So God's compassion is, you know, like if you put an example to us, when we're going through lots of trials of life, lots of just overall about life, you know, like life, we say to ourselves, like, man, I get it hard. No, all of us. The Bible even say that all of us go trials, right? Go through a lot of trials in our life. But God, from far away, he could see us already, like seeing the crowd. He could see us from, not from a distance. He knows ahead of time already what we need, what miracle that we need, what you know, what we need in this life. And God never fails. God is always there for us. And he, for him to be compassionate to the 5,000, he's also compassionate to us, for us to end this in this life. Because in this world today, there's a lot of bad things, to put it into one word. There are a lot of bad things, really bad. And it's going crazy. You know, I mean, talking about just the gender thing going on, and the school wants to indoctrinate our kids. You know, let's pray for our kids. But he knows us. He knows our needs. And we need to depend on God. We need to depend on him because he's so compassionate. So we already know that, right? It's just a reminder to all of us that God is a compassionate God. He's not there like with a baseball bat and whack you because you fail, because I fail. God is a loving God. God is a merciful God. Remember that. God is a merciful God. He's very compassionate to each one of us. And let's not forget that. Maybe you say to yourself, I'm embarrassed because I fall short of God's word. Yeah, we are embarrassed. But come before the Lord. He is compassionate and faithful in forgiving us of our sin, our shortcomings in our lives. Okay, my number two point. I'm going to finish early, so you guys can go eat. My number two point, trust the Lord, the great I am. Amen. Trust the Lord. Now, this is not a trick question, okay? So you can raise your hand. You don't have to raise your hand. But this is not a trick question, okay? How many of us has one, at least one friend? Raise your hand. At least one. No? Not everybody? I'm kind of shocked. Everybody's not raising their hand. Are you guys ashamed that you have a friend? Really? We should have at least one friend, right? Right? Well, if you don't have a friend and you have a fur baby, like a dog, dog best friend, so you have a friend, right? Right? Facebook friends. What's important in a friendship? What's important in when you have a friend? What's important? Trust is very important, right? Trust is very important. What happens when the trust is break? You have to build it up somehow, but it takes, right? Trust is very important when you have a friend. Have a friend. Become enemy? Sister Megan said, become enemy? No, we forgive each other, right? Trust is very important. So Jesus here, Jesus asked Philip, Philip, there's a big crowd coming out here, about 5,000 of them. That's excluding women and children, right? We all know that. So probably 12 to 15. Some preachers said even 25,000 people. That's if people bring their whole family, right? So Philip is being asked. I gotta use my. So Philip is being asked. That's in verse 7. Put that up on. Okay, verse 7. Philip answered him, it would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. So Philip here, when Jesus asked Philip, Philip, you know, like, the reason why Jesus asked Philip, he could ask anybody else, right? Tell me why he asked Philip. Okay. What, One of the reasons why he asked Philip, because Philip was in that neighborhood. He lives in that area, right? So asking Philip, he said, Philip, you live in this area? Where can we get the food to feed these people? So Philip's thinking, man, it's going to take about 8 months of wages to feed these people. You know, so Philip, he's being practical, but being practical is okay, but like he's next to Jesus, right? Did he forget about Jesus? Did he forget about Jesus turning the water into wine? Did he forget about Jesus healing the sick? But he saw the people, right? His eyes were focused on the people, not Jesus. He could have said, God, Lord, it takes 8 months of wages, but you know what? You're here. But he didn't do that because he was like probably panic or I think he's being practical. Can you imagine Jesus coming to Elk Grove and say, Alex, what can we get the food to feed these 5,000 people? Yeah, I was thinking about that for the last couple of days. If that happened to me, I said, Jesus, you know, I start calculating, like, okay, what can we get the food, right? Jollibee or McDonald's? Honestly, it's too expensive, right? It's too much money. So I've been thinking, if that really happened, I'll be thinking, okay, who's the cook in this church? I've been thinking about Brother Rainey, Sister Evelyn, right? Right? And I say, I need bread, so I see, I need Sister Laurie, right? She had pandesal salt and Spanish bread. But besides that, though, we need the money. Not only we need the money, we need time to cook it. By the time you cook it, it's like a couple of days past. The people already went home, right? So I've been thinking about that, and then to put it, myself into Philip. Philip is being practical, but however, he forgot that Jesus was next to him. You know, Jesus was next to him. And a lot of times in our lives, when we need things in our lives, when we need simple things in this life, we look at people, we look at how much money we have in the bank. Perhaps we don't have time left to do it. Whatever it is, circumstances in our life, we look at those things, but we forget that there is a God who created the universe that can help us. Now remember now, God, our Lord Jesus Christ, don't have to answer our prayers, you know that. But He is able. He is able to answer because He is God. He knows best. He is sovereign in our life. And sometimes our prayer is not answered, we get frustrated, right? Frustrated, God doesn't love me. He did it for that person over there. That person has this, that person has that. Well, you're not God. I'm not God. The Lord is God. The Lord is God. And He is the great I Am. And I have verses for that. Exodus 3:14. God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. So this is Moses. Remember Moses before he went to Egypt to free the Israelites? And Moses said to God, what's your name? What is your name, Lord? I am. If I were to ask you, what is your name? You will say, my name is Brother Paul, right? My name is Sister Grace. But our God, He don't need, in the beginning He said, I am. When He says, I am, He is God. He's from the beginning. He has no beginning. He has no end. And He says in John 8:58, Truly, I tell you, Jesus answered, before Abraham was born, I am. So these people, like, because Jesus, in that time, is telling the people who he came to be, that he is the Messiah, and he is God. And they said to him, you're not even 50 years old, and you said that you were born before Abraham? He said, Jesus said, I am before Abraham. I am before Abraham. So trusting God, who is has no beginning, who has no end, remember the great I am. Remember him. Trust him. Even though Philip didn't realize the great I am that he's standing next to him, sometimes we do forget Jesus. We forget our Lord, right? As a matter of fact, sometimes not only forget him, we somewhat abandon him. Say, God, you don't answer my prayers, so I'm not going to go to church. I'm not going to join Bible study. I'm not going to do this, do that. That's the wrong way to do. The more you get closer to God and trust him. Imagine this. We have the scripture. We have the Holy Bible to read what happened in the past. And sometimes we don't have that still faith to believe the great I am, the great God that we serve. You guys okay? So Philip, he was more concerned of the what he sees, right? So who's the next person Jesus talked to? If you're following the scriptures, Andrew. So Andrew spoke up, like, okay, just 12. Jesus talked to you, Philip first. He said, hey, Philip, and then Andrew probably raised your hand. Jesus, there's a young man here. There's a young man here with how many loaves? 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Now, you look at the verses, barley. Barley is the cheapest form of wheat. It's for the poor. So, that said, this boy is poor. He has just barley, bread, and, I don't know, 2 sardines, 6 small fish. So, it's not much. His mom packed him a simple lunch. Imagine this boy, though. He went on his way by himself. Doesn't, if you have balum for yourself, you were thinking the parents wasn't there. Maybe the parents stayed home. So he went. He went. So the boy is not even counted in the total of the 5,000. So the boy made himself available. So imagine this, 12 to 15,000 in that hillside. The boy found himself to go to the front. But normally you'd have the, like, since the men is counted, like, they're like more, I don't know, special, or they're just, you know, the man is doing the front, but this boy went to where he can be seen by Andrew. So this boy is, he wants to see what's going on. He wants to know what's going on here. And that's come to my point about mentioning the youth of New Life Christian Fellowship. And they are doing a great job. Doing a great job. I want to name the leaders. Brandon, Gabby is led by them. Then we have Nathaniel, Kelly, Kaslyn, and Landon. And Amber. Sorry. So they're doing a great job. Let me tell you this, youth. You coming to church is not in vain. is not in vain. I get emotional when I say that because I'm part of the youth one time. A lot of sacrifices. You may be quiet. A youth that is hardly saying anything. A youth that is not, seems like, sorry now, I'm not doing anything, but don't underestimate those youth. Because one time, when I was a youth, I know this young man who was very quiet, don't say much, comes to church, joined the youth. Has the guitar. You know who this I'm talking to? I mean, about? That's your feel. So don't underestimate those youth who's not, seems like he's not, they're not doing anything. Be careful. They'll be pastor someday, elder one day, church council member one day. Maybe head this ministry one day, mission. So youth, don't give up. I encourage you to keep coming. Encourage one another. Because this young lad, this young boy, went to the front and be used and be part of the miracle of feeding the 5,000. Sorry, I get emotional. So we give God the glory for our youth. Encourage them, church. Perhaps we correct them, but don't discourage them. We should not discourage them. We can rebuke them with love, but please encourage them. So he is used, this young lad is encouraged, used to feed the 5,000. Sorry, Pastor, I used the other name, talk to you for permission, but. Are we making ourselves available like the young boy? Not only talking to you, to all of us. Be accessible. Be used for God. Be upfront. Be available. Don't wait for the next person to say, well, this sister and so, or this brother and so got it. Just because I can include that doesn't mean you don't have to cook. You get my point? Right? Just because you love to cut the grass, a person in life when you cut grass doesn't mean you don't have to cut the grass. Be part of the team. Be part of the church as a whole. We help each other, right? We help each other. So this young boy, and I can never overemphasize, this young boy made himself available. So for us, we need to make ourselves available to be used by God. So as you know, Jesus prayed for the loaves and fishes. And he prayed for it. He broke the bread and the fish. He ate. It was a buffet. It's not like, okay, cut that in half. In fact, God is so organized, as we know. He told them to sit down, divide into 50, I think, and hundreds. There's reasons for that. Those scriptures are not there just to be read. I believe, this is just me thinking, 50 and 100. Some people doesn't want to be in a big crowd. Some people want to be in a big, happy and noisy crowd, right? Some people want to be in a small crowd, but they divided themselves, right? And I believe that the disciples, they say, okay, you belong here. I believe the people decided among themselves to divide. Once they decided to divide yourself, they divided. be divided. So God is very detailed in this miracle. So 5 loaves and 2 fishes equals, or plus Jesus equals miracle. It's a miracle. It takes Jesus to perform a miracle, obviously. We can't do it. None of us can. And we shouldn't wait for a big miracle to happen so we can rejoice and be glad and be happy. Thank God for the small miracle as well. Do we take it for granted? We shouldn't take it for granted for the small miracle. Waking up in the morning is a miracle by itself, right? Another day of life. Now my closing. Now the feeding of the 5,000 is a lesson for the disciples. The miracle is for the 5,000 because they got their food, right? They got fed. But the lesson of the miracle of the loaves and fishes is for the disciples, for them to see that Jesus performed this miracle. They need to trust Him. They need to trust Jesus as they walk with Him, that has been taught. Jesus talking to them and showing miracles. So it's a lesson, life lesson for the disciples. And we are the disciples of Jesus. Amen? So it's a life lesson for us. We read the scriptures about the miracles. It's a life lesson for us to say, God, You're awesome. God, You're amazing. How many basket full of bread was left over? 12, right? 12 baskets. Is there a significant on that? 12 baskets? 12 disciples, right? Right? So they picked up the leftovers, basket full of bandasal or whatever you want to call it. And one for each disciple. And I believe this leftover for the disciples to perhaps they're bound for the next day, share it to their loved ones, share it to their friends. But I believe it reminded them of that miracle that day. Reminded them that God is an amazing God, God that performed miracles. Jesus performed the miracle. And secondly, if you read the preceding the verses ahead from verse 16, they got into a boat. What happened in the boat? There's a storm, right? There's a storm. And in this life, sometimes we're on the mountaintop, but a lot of time we're in the valley. Remember the Mount of Transfiguration when the disciples tell Jesus that, let's build a hut for you and Elijah and Moses? Because they were on the mountaintop. They want to preserve that moment on the mountaintop, because they're so high, they're happy with Jesus and Elijah and Moses. What happened afterwards? They went down the valley, right? Reality time, right, so to speak. So it is life. We are more on the valley part of life than on the mountaintop. But remember, Jesus went down with them in the valley. For us today, Jesus is always besides us when we're in the valley of life, life that is full of discouragement, full of trials, full of temptation, full of discouragement. Let us remember that Jesus is also there for us in tough times. So my conclusion today, in every moment of our life, every day, every week, every month, every year, every decade. I don't want to say century, but I don't think all of us, none of us, maybe we'll live 100 years, you never know. We need to always trust Jesus. He knows it all. The miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, I'll simply say this. Jesus used a simple lunch of a boy. Simple lunch. To perform a miracle. Trust the Lord, the great I am. Remember I said Genesis 1:1, God created the heaven and the earth. The great I am. Remember that. Don't forget that. And lastly, the Lord uses anyone, great and small. You might feel like you're insignificant here in church. Like, you don't have a title, you know, whatever it is, don't say that. Because God can use any one of us for His kingdom and for His glory and His honor, right? Obviously, all of us can be a pastor, right? Like, God gives us the gift, talent that we can use in this life. Us individually has this talent. Use it. And I see that already, all of us. Like I mentioned earlier, the youth. I mean, some of the youth is already doing multitasking. A lot of things that involve different ministries. So He uses the great and small. And I also want to just shout out to the department heads for the church. You know, like Sister Nelly, Christian Education, Sister Faith for the children's church, for the young adult by Tiffany and Brother Mike, and obviously Pastor Sister Nelly, I mean Sister Charlie for the church. I mean, all the leaders of the church. You will know that your work is not in vain. We're not doing, you know that we're not doing it for ourselves, but for the Lord, and for the Lord only. Do not be discouraged and do not be dismayed, for the Lord, your God, is there forever until He comes. Amen.
As we close with this song.